Chapter 3. I must say I was rather eager during the ensuing weeks and very relieved when the first day of the next month rolled around. I was sitting in my office, working on other matters, trying to keep my mind occupied and off the fact that Jason Stevens would be arriving shortly. Finally, the buzzer on my telephone sounded and Miss Hastings informed me that young Jason Stevens had arrived and was waiting in the conference room. I collected the appropriate files and Miss Hastings retrieved Red Stevens' box from the wallet. When we entered the conference room, we found Jason slammed back in a chair with his feet upon the conference table. I strode across the room and slid the box that Margaret had handed me onto the conference table in such a way as to knock Jason's feet off the conference table. I said, "Good morning, Jason. I am glad that you found a chair and are making yourself comfortable. Some people never have learned the proper use of furniture." Jason dismissed my comment with a bold wave and said, "Can we just get on with it here? I have got things to do and people to see." I laughed aloud as I sat down and said, "Young man, I do anticipate you will have things to do and people to see. But it may not be exactly as you think." I took another video tape from the box and handed it to Margaret. She placed it in the video player and in a few moments, Red Stevens appeared on the large screen. He said, "Good morning, Ted, and to you, Miss Hastings. Once again, I want to thank you for undertaking this little chore. And Jason, I want to remind you of the rules. If at any time during the next year you do not perform as called for or Mr. Hamilton does not approve of your attitude and demeanor, he will simply stop the process and cut you off from my ultimate gift to you. I will warn you about Mr. Hamilton. He may appear very patient and long-suffering, but young man, if you push him too far, you will find that you have let an angry tiger out of his cage." Jason looked at me with a bewildered expression on his face. I simply stared back at him. Red paused and seems to be remembering days gone by. He continued, "Jason, when I was much younger than you are now, I learned the satisfaction that comes from simple four-letter words, work. One of the things my wealth has robbed from you and entire family is the privilege and satisfaction that comes from doing an honest day's work." I could see Jason's rolling his eyes as he let out a deep sigh. Red continued, "Now before you go off the deep end and reject everything I'm going to tell you, I want you to realize that work has brought me everything I have and everything that you have. I regret that I have taken from you the joy of knowing that what you have is what you have earned. My earliest memory in the swamps of Lucania are of working hard, back-breaking labor that as a young man I resented greatly. My parents had too many mouths to feed and not enough food. So if we wanted to eat, we worked. Later, when I was on my own and I came to Texas, I realized that hard work had become a habit for me and served as true joy all the rest of my life. Jason, you have enjoyed the best things that this world has to offer. You have been everywhere, seen everything, and done everything. What you don't understand is how much pleasure these things can bring you when you have earned them yourself. And leisure becomes a reward for hard work instead of a way to avoid work. Tomorrow morning, you are going to take a little trip with Mr. Hamilton and Miss Hastings. You will be going to meet an old friend of mine on a ranch outside of Alpine, Texas. When I was young and struggling to stay alive during the Depression, I missed Gus Caldwell. We learned the power of hard work then, and there is no one better to teach you this lesson than Gus. I already prepared a letter outlining this entire situation to be sent to Gus Caldwell. Mr. Hamilton has forwarded that letter to Alpine, Texas, and Gus Caldwell will be expecting you. Please remember, if at any time you do not complete the activities outlined in my will, or if Mr. Hamilton is not pleased with your attitude, this endeavor will simply end. and you will forgo the ultimate gift. The screen went black. This is ridiculous. Jason shouted at me angrily. I smiled and replied, yes, dealing with you can be trying. But there are some things you just do for friends like Red Stevens. I will see you at the airport at 6:45 in the morning. Jason looked at me as if he were addressing an imbecile. He said, did not they have any flights later in the day? I replied with more patience than I felt. Yes, but Mr. Caldwell, I think you will find, is not one who wants to waste any time. See you tomorrow. Jason left our office and Margaret made all the necessary arrangements. The next morning, just as the airline attendant was preparing to close the door, a blurry-eyed Jason Stevens came running down the concourse. Margaret handed the attendant the tickets for the three of us and we boarded the plane. Margaret and I took our assigned seats, which were the first two seats on the right side of the aircraft in the first class. Jason stood there with a confused expression on his face as there were no more seats in the first class cabin. He turned to me and said, where is my seat? Margaret responded to his question using her most efficient tone, but I knew she was enjoying every moment of this when she said, oh, Mr. Stevens, you have been assigned a seat 23F. She handed Jason his ticket stub and he stormed down the aisle. When we got off the plane at the Midland Odessa airport, Gus Caldwell was there to meet us. I had known Gus for years as a friend and associate of Red Stevens. We shared a mutual love of our lifetime friend. Gus shook my hand warmly with the callous grip of a man 35 instead of what I knew must be his real age of 75. He greeted Margaret politely but was somewhat gruff with Jason. He said to Jason, Red Stevens was one of the best men I ever met. I don't see how you are going to live up to that. As Jason was preparing to protest the cold greeting, Gus shot back at him, son, why don't you go downstairs and see if you can find the luggage? Make yourself useful. A few moments later, we were downstairs in the airport and Jason had indeed located all of the luggage. Gus pulled around the parking lot to pick us up at the door in his deluxe pickup truck, a vehicle we rarely see in Boston. Gus held the door for the Margaret and me and said to Jason, well, don't just stand there, boy. Get these bags in the trunk. Jason loaded all of the luggage in the bed of the pickup truck and then asked sheepishly where I am supposed to sit. Gus said, you can ride in the back or walk. It is all the same to me. Gus got in and began to pull away just as Jason scrambled into the bed of pickup truck. I glanced back at and saw him sprawled out amongst the luggage, rolling around from side to side. As Gus summarily ignored all of the speed limit signs as we left the airport complex, Gus drove us to his sprawling rank. He discussed memories of Red and our desire to help Red redeem Jason Stevens. We agreed that Gus would help spend the next 4 weeks communicating his versions of work ethic to Jason, while Margaret and I would leave the following day and spend several weeks in Austin, where I was to do some legislative work for another client. After traversing what seems to be an endless gravel road, we turned into a driveway that led off into a distance. A sign read, Gus Caldwell's Ranch. Friends are welcome, trespassers will be shot. After another 10-minute drive, we arrived at a huge ranch house where we were greeted by Gus' extended family, several of his workers, and a number of dogs. Gus led Margaret and me into his comfortable home and yelled back at Jason, don't just lay there in the truck, boy. Get the bags. Gus had informed Margaret and me that the next day would be start early at the Caldwell Ranch. He decided to let Jason find out the hard way. The next morning, Margaret and I and all of the Caldwell's family enjoyed a huge breakfast of a monumental cholesterol before 6 a.m. As we were enjoying our second cups of coffee, Gus said, well, I better go and get Sleeping Beauty. This is going to be an interesting day. Real educational, if you know what I mean. We could hear Gus climbing the stair
and banging upon the doors, Jason's room. He called out in a thunderous voice, "Boys are alive. You are sleeping through the whole day. Here, get dressed and get downstairs." Gus rejoined us and we chatted amiably over the strong coffee, and a few minutes later, a disheveled, sleepy-eyed Jason joined us and sat down at the table. No sooner was he seated than the Gus rose and said, "Well, that was a good breakfast. Time to get to our work." Jason glared at him and said belligerently, "Can I have some breakfast, please?" Gus smiled and he said, "Yes, sir. First things tomorrow morning."
Nobody ever leaves Gus Caldwell's home hungry. But there's not much I can do if people are going to sleep all day. Jason looked out the window and exclaimed, "It is not even a daylight yet." Gus chuckled and replied, "That's very observant, son. I thought I was going to teach you everything. Now get out to the bunkhouse and see if you can find some work clothes. That's about the most worthless getup you have on there I have ever seen. We will be leaving in about 5 minutes. Gus agreed to take Margaret and me out to where Jason would be working to see him get started before we would leave for Austin. We were seated in the truck when Jason stumbled out of the bunkhouse and dutifully climbed into the back of the pickup truck. Before he was seated, Gus shot out across the yard and drove through a gate, bouncing out across an immense field. Just as the sun was rising, Gus stopped at the remote corner of the rank where a huge pile of a fence post lay on the ground. Gus jumped out of the truck and yelled, "Boy, would you get out of that pickup bed? I have never seen one for laying around like you." Margaret and I followed Gus and Jason to the last fence post standing in a long line that stretched out of the sight. Gus proclaimed proudly, "Welcome to fence post 101. He quickly showed Jason how to dig a post hole, set the post and string the wire in a straight line. Even at 75, Gus Caldwell showed immense strength and incredible stamina. He made everything look easy. He turned to Jason and said, "Now you try." And Gus joined the Margaret and me near the truck. Jason stumbled through the process almost comically, and Gus called out, "Well, hopefully you will get the hang of it or beat yourself to death. Once somebody will come by to pick you up for the noon meal." Jason seemed alarmed and called out, "How far is the fence supposed to go?" As Gus helped Margaret and me into the truck, Gus laughed and said, "No more than a mile, and then we will turn and go the other way. Don't worry, we won't run out of the things for you to do. I wish I had a dollar for every fence post good old Red Stevens and I dug all across Texas." We left Jason there to his labors. Almost 4 weeks later, Margaret and I returned from a successful trip to the Texas state capital in Austin. Gus once again picked us up at the airport and said, as we were driving the 2 hours to his ranch, I couldn't help but ask, "Well, how is young Jason getting along?" Gus chuckled and said, "I was not sure he was going to make it. Between the sunburn, blisters and the heat exhaustion, it was a close thing, but I think you are in for a pleasant surprise." When we reached the rank, Gus drove us directly to the field where Jason had been working the first day. I noticed that the fence extended far beyond its original point, and Jason was nowhere in sight. Gus drove on a distance, and once we crested a short rise, I spotted Jason in the distance. An amazing transformation had taken place. Jason was browned by the sun, lean from his physical behavior, and working steadily as we arrived. He waved to us and walked over to join us, and we got out of the truck. I asked Jason, "Did you dig all those post holes and set all those posts yourself?" He seems to have gleam in his eye as he said, "Yes, sir. Every one of them, and they are straight too." Gus put his arms around Jason's shoulder and said, "Son, I was not sure you were going to make it, but you turned into a really good hand. Your great uncle Red and I discovered nearly 60 years ago that if you can do this kind of work with pride and a quality, that you can do anything. I think you have learned your lessons. Now it's time to get back to Boston. I was shocked when Jason replied, I only have a few more to finish up this section. Why don't we leave in the morning? The next day after breakfast, Gus volunteered to drive us to the airport. Jason dutifully carried the bags out onto the porch, but instead of pickup truck, Gus was driving a new Cadillac. Jason laughed and asked, where is your truck, Mr. Cadwell? Gus smiled and replied, I can't have one of my best hands rolling around in the back of the truck with the luggage. Now let's get you to the airport. As we flew 30,000 feet above middle America, I couldn't help to but think of Red Stevens and the lesson on a work he had taught Jason. I hope the lesson meant as much to Jason as it did to me.